physicists, scientists, clinicians, and social scientists. The series of five weekly lectures is offered in 100 credits, and so here we are. We have about 30 people, 35 in the room right now, and about how many online? Also got a Master's of Public Health in Columbia University in New York. He did an internship in New York Hospital, Queens, and residency, and then research fellow and clinical fellow glaucoma at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, where he is right now as an assistant professor in the Department of Ophthalmology and Visual Sciences in the Survey Research Center in Ann Arbor, Michigan. He also does clinical practice, and he concentrates on medical and surgical treatment of glaucoma. He also mentors residents, faculty members, postdocs, medical students, and I'm giving you the summary of his long curriculum vitae. He has grants from the research from the National Institute on Aging and the National Eye Institute. He's going to talk about those, I'm sure, about the work he's doing in the United States, in Kenya, and in India. Like I said, a very young investigator, when you look at someone who's been an assistant professor for 6-7 years, and you count more than 130 peer-reviewed publications, and say, Josh, how did you have time to come see us? But thank you very much. Thank you for coming. We enjoyed talking with you all day today. Thank you for spending the day with many of our investigators. And thank you for giving this talk.
Thank you very, very much for that kind introduction. Maybe on the young side, I wish I were truly as young as as you say, but I'm really honored to be here today and to be a part of this lecture series, and would like to thank you, Dr. Long, the other faculty here at UTMB, who I've had the pleasure of dining with and spending the day with today, and learning about all of the wonderful work that's going on here. It's really just a pleasure to be here, and an honor to be part of this lecture series, so thank you all. And so I'll be discussing today the epidemiology of vision loss and aging, and this is where a lot of my work is focused. And this is where oftentimes I find kind of at the periphery of geriatrics and gerontology. And I hope today in my talk to really articulate why I think this is a vital aspect of the aging process and why this is deserving really of all of our attention as a topic of interest. I have no financial interest or disclosures with anything I'll be talking about today. I'd like to present an outline of the main topics that I'll talk about. So I'm going to start by talking a talk about, very generally, some of the implications of vision impairment and blindness on the lives of older adults, on aspects of life beyond how older adults see the world, but also how we experience the world. And then I'll focus the last third or so of the talk on vision and dementia. And so... see that the number of individuals age 60 and older worldwide has increased over the past and coming decades. It might not surprise anyone to learn that the number of vision impairment, the prevalence of vision impairment, increases with each decade of life. Cataract. These tend to happen in older segments of the population. And so putting these two pieces of information together, it's therefore logical that age being the number one risk factor for vision impairment and a growing older population, that the number of people with vision impairment and blindness is projected to grow considerably over the coming three or so decades, by about 60%. Now, I always like to point out that it's not all and that there have actually been a lot of successes. If we look back 30 years now, we've actually seen a decrease in the age standardized prevalence. That is, if the population of the Earth were remaining the same, weren't aging, and being kind of held constant, that age standardized prevalence has decreased in all regions of the world. And this has been achieved through global advocacy, advances in preventative medicine and delivery of care, innovations in clinical care. But, as noted, because the population is getting older, this is really outpaced by population aging, and we're still seeing more and more people with vision impairment. When we look at what's causing vision impairment globally, this pie chart depicts in very broad strokes what these causes are. And what I'd like to point out here, and what's likely already jumped out to many of you, is that there are two causes highlighted in blue on the slides here that account for more than 75% of cases globally. The really significant thing is not just that there are two causes accounting for more than 3/4 of cases, but that these two causes are readily addressable. One is the refractive error, or the need for glasses, so the unmet need for glasses. And the other is cataract, something that can be cured with a surgery. It turns out that providing eyeglasses and providing cataract surgery are actually two of the most cost-effective interventions in all of medical care. Now, there's some variation based on country as to what the number one, number two cause are and how much of the pie these two causes consume, but suffice it to say that even in the United States, the world over, these two causes are highly prevalent. So much of the data that I've shown you thus far has been focused on the world at large. But I want to step back for a moment and talk a little bit more specifically about the United States and what's going on here, what the epidemiological situation is here. Well, it turns out that most of the data that we have in the United States is based on self-report. That's large surveys, many of which are conducted by CDC, that go out into the community and then ask people, how well can you see? And there's a lot of value there. It has a lot to do with how people are experiencing their life, the environments in which they find themselves. But there's also a lot of value to objectively measuring somebody's vision, putting an eye chart up and asking them to read letters on the eye chart, and getting a quantitative measurement in that fashion. This has been very rare in national surveys in the United States. There is some local data from certain studies, but on a national scale, this has been rare, and in fact, until very recently, the last time that had been done on the national scale was 2008. So we were looking at data that was is 15 or more years old to make estimates about how much of the United States have vision impairment. The advancing is again there. It's just stuck. There we go. So, until very recently, and I'll talk to you about what has changed. So, several years ago, we proposed to address this data gap by implementing vision tests into a large national study called the National Health and Aging Trends Study. Our proposal was luckily adopted and has become part of the annual protocol in the National Health and Aging Trends Study, which includes about 8,000 older adults in the 48 United States and is representative of about 97% of the over 65 population in the United States. We now annually administer using an iPad in people's homes measures of distance visual acuity, near visual acuity, and contrast sensitivity. This depicts here the test of distance visual acuity. After hearing the test, you will get an ad at his office, if you run to the office, and the doctor said you will not come at all. So this test is situated on the iPad about a meter and a half away from the app and the participant, and if they look these eyes right, their eyes look progressively smaller. There's a similar test that's performed at reading distance, the iPad app is held in the participant's hands. And the third test is a test called contrast sensitivity. In this test, the test is more difficult by making the characters binary. So the contrast between the characters in the background becomes progressively smaller and they become more difficult to read. Interestingly, this test of contrast sensitivity is a better predictor of many of suspicion and sensitive substitute. System database, and it showed the cataract extraction, which pretty much universally improves vision and is done in older adults, was associated with a lower risk of development of dementia. But other forms of eye surgery that don't improve vision had no such association with dementia. So it seems to be something about taking cataracts off that matters here. And while I would argue that it's a very well-conducted retrospective study, it's so retrospective, it's still susceptible to unmeasured confounding and certain biases that a randomized trial is able to overcome. And so, I think there really is a need, and I think we've reached a point with the evidence that we have, the observational evidence that we have, that it's prudent to start thinking about randomized controlled trials that could be undertaken in an attempt to slow cognitive decline and even prevent dementia. And really, if I think about what those trials should look like, there's really two interventions that make sense. Either giving people eyeglasses or doing cataract surgery. Now, of course, giving eyeglasses is much less expensive than doing surgery. Eyeglasses, however, are susceptible to being lost or broken or a prescription change. So there's advantages and disadvantages to choosing one intervention over the other. But this is where I would go with this. Fortunately, there is a study that's just getting off the ground that I'm peripherally involved in called the Cognitive Level Enhancement for Vision Exams and Refraction, a clever study, and I'm not clever enough to come up with that acronym. In this study, older adults in India are randomized to immediate or delayed intervention with eyeglasses. These are people who need eyeglasses but don't yet have them, and their cognitive function is going to be followed over years after they receive the glasses to understand whether that trajectory of decline can be bent by improving vision. So stay tuned, more to come over the years ahead. So I'll leave you now with some concluding thoughts about vision impairment and aging. So we know that vision impairment impacts on many facets of life, including cognitive health. We also know, and there's pretty good evidence now, that vision may be a modifiable lever to optimize late life health and well-being, including our cognitive health and later life. But I'd be remiss to not mention that more longitudinal, generalizable, and both internally and externally valid data is needed to really drive this field forward. So I'd like to thank my many, many collaborators across this country and across the world who make this research possible, as well as our funding support from National Institutes of Health, Wellcome Trust, Research to Prevent Blindness, and especially thank all of you for having me here and for your attention today, and I think we should have time for some questions as well. So thank you.
So how many people did we have out there? Thank you. We're going to have questions now. Can you take the questions?
Of course, of course. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, that's a good question. So people are asked if they have glasses. So this is let me back up for a moment. The National Health and Aging Trend Study is a study that's really interested in late life disability. That's the framework that NHATS. And so in designing the vision test, it was important to us to design the vision tests as people are living their lives. So that means both eyes open, not covering one eye and testing the chest up there, just people with that face with both eyes open. And if they have glasses for seeing at that particular distance, the contrast is up, it's a distance test. If you have eyeglasses for seeing across the room, you ask you to wear your eyeglasses for that test. If you don't have eyeglasses, that may be the cause of your impairment. We recognize that, and that's a limitation that we're going to suss out what's due to unfortunate fact of other versus other causes. How it plays a role in other health outcomes, like dementia. Yeah, so when we look at those sorts of things, we find that a couple of things. Vision impairment matters independent of whether those factors are present. So we can put everything kind of together in a statistical model and find that there's an independent effect. But not only that, we find with many other risk factors that there's a potentiating effect. So if we look at people that have just cardiovascular disease, I'll take that as an example since that's the one you cited, just cardiovascular disease or just vision impairment or the two of them together, we find a potentiating effect when people have vision impairment plus some of these other risk factors. And in some cases, it's sort of the whole is more than the sum of the parts, right? And it's even a multiplicative effect in some cases. Oftentimes we see that multiplicative effect when we look at dual sensory impairment. So vision and hearing in the same individual. It's a fascinating question. I just don't know the answer. That's far outside of my expertise, but I think it's a fascinating question that just highlights how there's so much room in the space for not only social scientists and epidemiologists, but also for neuroscientists and many other disciplines that can bring their expertise to the table. Yeah. That's one of the things that I was mentioning sort of in those concluding slides. I don't know the answer to that either. The prevalence tends to be quite low, right? So we certainly don't have a big enough sample in any of these national studies to be able to make a generalizable conclusion, but I think that with the right electronic health record data or even claims data, one could try to get at that question, but I'm not aware of anybody who's looked at that. Not to say they haven't, I'm not aware of it. But I think it's an interesting question because it also might allow us to start getting at this question of, like, you know, maybe there's so much compensatory adaptation early on, right, that people don't, you know, or maybe it's the length of time lived with the vision impairment really is important and clearly elevates some of this risk. And I don't know the answer, but I think it's important research. Yes? Yeah, so I could have given a whole other talk on that topic, and that's a really, really interesting area, the sort of the eye as a biomarker. And there's this emerging field that's been coined oculomics. Everything has to be an omic. So it's oculomics, and that's thinking about ocular imaging and what features are manifest in those ocular images and maybe able to predict other health outcomes, like dementia and cognitive decline. You know, the eye really is embryologically an extension of the brain. And there is good emerging evidence for using certain types of ocular imaging to predict if not associations, but starting to get longitudinal data that suggests the eye may be a good biomarker of things like Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease in particular. So I think more to come I would say, because there are a lot of people, myself included, working on this. More to come over the decades ahead as we get more and more years of data, because it really takes time to get those images and then see people develop disease. But really a lot of the work in that space has been facilitated by machine learning and AI, because there are so many features manifest in these photographs and images that we can get of the eye that a human just doesn't pick up on. There's a fascinating study that the group at Google actually published a few years ago now. And they showed that by training a set of just color photographs at the back of the eye, and I should back up and say the eye is the only part of the human body where we can see directly both blood vessels and nerves. So they used color photographs at the back of the eye, the retina, and they trained a set on people's gender, sex, systolic and diastolic blood pressure, smoking history, probably one or two other variables I'm not remembering, and then they had their validation sample, just unknown data that fed into the algorithm, and with unbelievable accuracy, they were able to predict smoking history, systolic and diastolic blood pressure, diabetes status was another one, maybe less surprising, sex, male or female. These are all things that a human, when they look at a retina photograph or a retina in, you know, the patient in the clinic, can't tell. So there's a lot manifest in those photos and those even more advanced types of imaging that are really untapped but hold tremendous potential. Yeah, I mean, I think that's something that just really has not been sorted out, but it's, I have to imagine that those same markers are manifest in the eye, and that, you know, that the inflammation is probably detectable, rather something I can see or you could see, or just, you know, something that's there that we can pick up with these, you know, with our eye. I have to imagine it's there. I actually read a story in the popular news today that my wife had sent me from NPR, that was talking about a group at Northwestern that's looking at, it's a very comprehensive aging study, but one of the things they're thinking about is biological versus chronological age. You know, maybe we can pick up through images of the eye whether or not certain therapeutics that seek to slow biological aging are having an intended effect. I don't know, but that's certainly something for the future. Yes? Thank you. some cross-national comparative studies. But it's, you know, it's very tough because a lot of times the data that enables us to study across countries may not have the cause data, right? So it may be great in that it's on a national scale and it's for the student in the US or Mexico or wherever, but oftentimes the data doesn't tell you about cause, right? So an accident versus the fact that it versus cataract. From the work that we've done, and probably the best data set that's been out there to date, comes with a whole slew of caveats, has been data from the same study because it was across several countries and collected the same way, including vision data, Mexico, China, India, Ghana, and South Africa. And we found that socioeconomic factors were important correlates, had important associations with vision impairment across countries. But that there was some variation in, say, education as a predictor versus income and wealth as a predictor. So there are some variation there, but yeah, I think it's very interesting. And that could also be important information for kind of targeted public health policy, and certain policies exist in one place versus not another. Yes?
What are the thoughts on the facts on that they're considered a public medical service by Medicare?
Yeah, I think it's crazy. You know, we got very close with a bill just a few years ago that would have included vision benefits in Medicare as a standard fee-for-service benefit at the last minute it was cut from the bill. It was about the closest we ever got. Unfortunately, the only time that fee-for-service Medicare will pay for eyeglasses is following cataract surgery. Otherwise, there is no benefit. I've seen a lot of those not in. Otherwise, there is no benefit. Some Medicare Advantage plans include it as a benefit. Most private insurers do not, outside of the Medicare context, most private insurers do not unless you have separate vision insurance. So it's a real access issue. Becomes an even bigger access issue for people with low vision who need things like vision rehabilitation devices, which are not classified as durable medical equipment, like say a rocket would be, but are rather covered under the same Medicare statute as eyeglasses. So, not covered. Some Medicaid. I know. It's vision, hearing, and oral health oftentimes go together in that respect.
Thank you very much. And we invite you to go outside and interact with Josh. Thank you so much, Josh.
Very pleasure.
And we're going to have cocktails. Cocktails out there, and we apologize. There were some sound issues for the remote people who couldn't have us. Well, we only had 8 people, but maybe, I don't know if you agreed to.